your word. We hear it. We receive it. We believe it. That we may be a doer of it. You increase. We decrease. We give you praise, honor, and glory. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. And I tell you that there's something really awesome that happens when we are child of God is we start, I think the one thing that's always takes some time more than other time for all of us is to know God as our Father, as our daddy, as our papa. Because based on the example of what we had as a natural father, when we are taught in the Lord's Prayer to pray our Father who art in heaven, to the level that we grow in the revelation of our papa or daddy, is of course to the level that we are growing in understanding that we are the beloved child. And it's to the level that we can communicate with him and pray and believe him. What I see a lot of times in a lot of mighty men of God and women of God is an incredible thing, is as we grow into that knowledge, we get to a place that we grow in sonship, and our growth in being a son takes us to a place that we are becoming like our Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. And this is a season that the Holy Spirit is taking sons to maturity. Many, many people in the world, what they need is to see that example as we are ambassadors of what our Heavenly Father look like. What does he look like? How does he talk? What does he like? What does he say? How does he walk? And of course, we have that example as Jesus, but make no mistake, as we are transformed into the image of the Son, we become an example to so many people. Oh, hallelujah. The Bible tells us in John, oh, God. Everything we learn about him is awesome, but to me, that's something that just changed my walk as a child, is daddy. And of course, I'm French, so I say papa. It's quiet. He said that in every language. Right? Abba. But in John chapter 1, we read in verse 12, we read, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Thank you, Lord. And then if you make a left, I wanna go to Luke 15. And for those who don't know the story, I wanna read the story of the prodigal. And in chapter 15, in verse of Luke, we read in verse 11, I'm reading out of the New King James Version. But how many knows we need the Holy Spirit version? And it says, then a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possession with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there was a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the parts that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father." Say, "I will arise and go to my father." Say it again, "I will arise and go to my father." I felt an anointing on that sentence. Say it again, "I will arise and go to my father. And will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants." And he arose and came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your sons." But the father said to his servants, "Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and he's found." And they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf." Calf, whatever. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, "Lord, these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him." And he said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive, and was lost and is found." You know, there's something in this story that we see, and that we love when we see how the prodigal is welcomed by his father, how father even saw him afar off. And make no mistake, the father knew when he gave him the money that he needed to allow him to see what he could do with it before he would arise and go to his father, knowing that apart from his father, if he tries to be out there and do anything apart from who he's supposed to be, sooner or later. Say, well, when I see people seek the Lord, it's amazing to me how if they need a maid, they come to church, they read the Bible, they ask everybody to pray for them. If they need a job, they just, you know, they're at the church every time the doors open, and they have their name on all the prayer lines. And if they expect a big breakthrough, and if they go to the doctor and they have anything in their body, glory to God, they get up and get on their knees and pray. pray. And if something happened in the world, like when we had the 9/11 and all the atrocity, people seek God and people pray. And people know how to seek God when they in want, but when they have everything and when they forget about their Father, that they don't arise and go to their Father, that they only arise and go to their Father when they need something. They don't want to go there. And this prodigal, you see how he went from being rebellious to really being repentant and finding out, I just need you. I seek you. I'd rather be a servant in your house than be out there. I just make me whatever you want me to be, but I cannot try to go without you. And you know, whether you look at the prodigal or whether you look at the older son, I'm looking at this story today in us becoming like our Father. Yeah. Because I found often that it's one thing to read a story and see how it's awesome, that when you realize that you've sinned, that you can repent and receive forgiveness. But here, that as we are walking and representing our Father, then can we forgive others? As much as we read the story and say, oh, what an awesome Father that he welcomed him back. Yeah, are we ready to welcome some people back? Yeah, as much as even Jesus said, be merciful, have compassion, just as our Father has compassion. Oh, we're so good at receiving forgiveness, being welcome, receiving compassion. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, hey, here I am. Lord, just hey. Yeah, but as you grow into sonship, in maturity, the whole creation is waiting for the manifestations of the sons of God. Those who represent their heavenly Father and now in turn are going to have open arms. Who in turn going to have compassion and mercy, understanding and love and forgiveness. Because the people that are in need are coming into the church like you have never seen people coming into the church. So then you have the older brother. I don't know if you're here and you have children or grandchildren, you know, it's always the one that's going through trouble that kind of need your most attention, don't they? You might have siblings that really think that maybe you make preferential treatment. Or you're paying more attention to one grandchild to another, or one child to another, and it's because that one always gets in trouble. Yeah. And the other child, you really don't really think that you have to even talk to them that much. They're doing good. Doing good. I see that here in the church. There's people that are so faithful, and me as a spiritual parent, I might not call them every day. I might not meet with them every week. It might be days and days without me even saying anything to them. Not because I care less for them. But they have that relationship. I know that they're dependable, they're faithful, they're okay, we're in that relationship, they don't get in trouble. And they might see me pray for somebody all the time, meet with them, and they might wonder, well, why? Because the enemy always comes in between siblings to stir up some stuff. always comes in between siblings. And as we're learning to know him as our papa, as our daddy, many, many, many times people compare their relationship with him. Now, if you think about it, we've looked at hallowed be his name. We looked at him being Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Rahe. We looked at even how the Son manifested his name. But see, in the Old Testament, he wasn't Father. Oh, I just felt 500 religious spirits leave. He wasn't daddy. He wasn't papa. The difference with us being born again, to all those who received him, give them the power, not the dunamis power, but the right, the authority, the privilege. We have been adopted into the family. He's our daddy. See, in the Old Testament, you could think of Jehovah as God for other people, but not necessarily you. Before you're born again, you might hear of God, but he might be this God up there somewhere. But when you receive what Jesus has done, as you become a child yourself, you are now in a personal relationship, and he's your father, he's your papa, he's your daddy, hallelujah. And that's the difference, that's the whole gospel. That's why there is no way to Father God but through Jesus. And Jesus said, that they may be one as we are one. Yeah. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Yeah. There's something about having a personal relationship with him that you're calling him daddy, yeah. Father. Yeah. But you know, it's like when I tell people when they have a badge, you know, and they become reverent. Well, sometimes I'm thinking, you might have to hide that badge. Sometimes I'm thinking, you only want to wear that badge. Which badge is authority? The badge is authority. The power, the dynamis power is the gun. The authority is connected to his name. All those who believe in his name, give them authority. When you have a badge, when you call yourself a child of God, my God, and he's your daddy, there's something that happens, that just like if you wear a badge that you're reverend, you walk in a greater accountability. There's some responsibility with a title. Many people want a title, but they don't want the responsibility, because with the responsibility comes accountability. With accountability comes a desire to yield and to allow the Holy Spirit to help you grow. Because our part is to do what we need to do to grow into this sonship. There's some childish things that Father want us to just. Yes. So it's a tough. It's an incredible thought to think that the Holy Spirit is taking us into maturity. Yes. To be like our Father, isn't it? Yes. Because then suddenly you're thinking, "Whoa! I have to kind of look like my Father." I can tell people that I'm born of God and I'm sleeping with the swines. The swines gotta go. It's not where I belong anymore. So there was a season, maybe the swines were okay. But there come a moment that you have to understand and realize, I'm just gonna arise and go to my Father. I'm going to stop going here. I'm going to stop going there. I'm not going to depend on the swine. I'm not going to depend on other people. Whatever I can get on my own, I'm going to run out. I'm going to rise and go to my Father. I'm going to repent of my ways and allow Him to do whatever He needs to do in my life, because I am a child of God. I have not been born of the will of man, not of the flesh, not of the blood. I have been born of God. I have now the divine nature. I have now the DNA of my Father. So who I was, I'm no longer. Behold, all things are new. I am a new creation. And as I'm learning to be like my daddy, there's a whole lot of people that God's going to bring forth my path, that I'm going to be called to be an ambassador, an example of what my Father looks like, so that they can receive Him as their daddy, as their papa. Ha! Father, when you become like your daddy, you're learning to, you know how difficult it is to forgive, to love, to have compassion in your own ability. It's impossible. You might do it a few seconds if you have a good day. But it's impossible to do it in your own. But as the Holy Spirit is bringing you into maturity, you find yourself able to do what you couldn't do before. You find yourself just like Father. See, with the events of the world, what happens to me is I find myself many situations grieving. I find myself weeping. This week I was weeping. I said, Father, 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 Father. And He said, I know, I know, I know. He said, see, I've given you my love. You're grieving because of my love. You're grieving because of my compassion. Because in the body, if one rejoice, we all rejoice. But if one weep, we all weep. And then I heard that scripture, you know, in Matthew, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And I just started to understand that Father, even in this story, and Father even now, he's so loving. See, we can't even comprehend the love of our Papa. We can't even understand the love of our Papa. He's so loving. He's so loving. God gave His only begotten Son. See, Jesus, in a way, left His home to take upon Himself what the prodigal went through, take upon Himself what the self-righteous brother went through. He became us so He could conquer what was conquering us. He rose on the third day so that we could be reconciled to our Papa and call our Papa Father. Abba, Father. For the scripture tells us in Romans, for you, we have not received a spirit of bondage again to fear, but a spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. My favorite part in this whole story is that he, Father, was at the window looking. I don't know if you have children, but I've seen many parents, they, no matter what their kids go through, they're just at the window like, okay, how long is it gonna take them to figure this thing out? And you know you can't tell them anything, so they just... But you're waiting. You're waiting. You're waiting. And us as children of God, being like our daddy, we need to be waiting. We need to never give up on people. Never, never, never give up on people. Our Heavenly Father carried us. Through the work of the cross, we've been carried. We were in Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus carried our sorrows, carried everything. We need to be able to wait upon people to be transformed. We can't stop believing that the Holy Spirit is able to do what he came to do. We're not waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. He's here to convict. He's here to move. He's here to bring all the children into a knowledge of salvation. He's here to just take us to a place of maturity. Precious Holy Spirit. Is there some people in our lives that we stopped waiting? Is there some people in our lives that today when we think about fatherhood, we could still pray and believe and wait and believe when they call or when they're going to come, that at any time they're going to come? Or do we give people so much time to get it right? Father not only was waiting, but when he saw him afar off, he was waiting because he ran outside. He ran outside. He ran outside and he kissed him repeatedly. And let me tell you, he was stinking. Smelling bad. Sometimes we get so self-righteous that if we smell somebody smoke cigarettes, we just The other day I said hi to somebody and I could smell weed. And I said, oh, Father, I don't like that smell. He said, you remember when you smelled like that? Hallelujah. See, the older brother, I think, at times, people get born again and they're the prodigal, and then after a while, they become the older brother. And people go back and forth, you know, but praise God, today we're talking about becoming like daddy. Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise God, because the older brother, there's some people, it's a blessing. They really have never got into drugs. They never really got into alcohol. No, seriously. There's some people, they really just, they went to school, they went to college, they met their wife, they married their wife. Is anybody here? They were a virgin. They lived happily ever after, opened a business. But there's some people that don't go through the same thing as other people. But the ability that we have to call him Father, Daddy, is because each of us, we have a personal relationship with him. And what really helped me in my growth, because when you're growing from a little baby in diapers in the spirit to attain to adulthood, you go through stuff. You go through stuff because your Heavenly Father will wean you out of bottles you don't have no business sucking on. Do look straight ahead. He will just take you to a place of growth. He will take you to a place. And really what helped me is to be in my Father's house in the spirit, that he was my daddy, that I understood relationship. I understood after I was born again that I was in relationship with him. He was my father. And you know what a good father does? A good father, when you mess up, he it's not like mommy. That's, you know, if you hurt yourself playing ball or riding a bike, your mommy's gonna freak out. You know, don't you ever get on a bike again. Let's protect you from the world. Let's keep you in the bedroom, and let's never try this again. But Father, he's going to just clean you up and say, no, I know you can do this. I know you got this. I know you can ride this bike. So I'm going to help you. I might carry you for a while, but my plan and my purpose is for you to carry somebody else. I might just do it for you for a while, but I'm going to cause you to even desire more than a milk of the word. I'm going to cause you to be able to grow and know that even though sometimes you're not in fellowship with me, that because you can never lose that relationship, you will know how to arise and go back to your Father in all the carnal ways that you fall into. When my children were grounded or they did something wrong, they would have to go in their room. And while they were in their room, we were not talking. But they still were my daughters. But I was downstairs in the kitchen still thinking, oh, are they going to come out soon? They're gonna be sorry. I'm gonna prepare cookies just in case. I was thinking, I wonder if instead of 10 days, I should just cut it down 5 days based on how sorry they are. I just wonder, you know how you think and you just love, and well, Father is like that. You know, there's a whole lot of people that God, even after we born again and we're learning to grow, he lets us learn some lessons, doesn't he? He lets us, you know, he's got this big steak for us to eat, and he sees us cry and whine when we can't have the bottle. Have you ever seen a little kid being weaned of a bottle? Man, it's painful to watch. They're just like in total pain because they can't have this bottle. And the loving parent is like, oh, if you would already see the teeth that I have for you, if you could see the steak that you're going to be able to eat, you wouldn't be so upset about the bottle. You would be willing to let go of the bottle. It's because you have never had the filet mignon yet. So don't have a fear. Trust that your Father knows best. Father's got inheritance to release upon the mature children of God in this season like never before, because the whole creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. So in this season, the Holy Spirit is removing a whole lot of bottles. And he's helping people as they are walking into a new level of maturity, which is necessary for other people to be able to know him. He's putting you into a place to meet people that is telling you, hey, I want you to be like a father to them, not like older, younger, you know, but more like a spiritual parent, man or woman. So that's why the woman have to stop tripping.
All right. Yeah, all right.
Did I say that out loud? Because there's competition, there's all this thing that we need to be able to just be completely walking into such a level of maturity that we understand it's not about us, it's about the people that we are called to carry. We might not be happy with them, they might be walking with dirty diapers, falling. They might not know the scriptures. We know. Their breath might smell like they just had 500 vodkas. And then instead of things like the prodigal, it could be someone who is self-righteous. But Father is calling us to be like Father and come along their side. And love them and have compassion and feed them what we know. How did we get to walk where we are that and we just knew how to do it? No. We had to learn, didn't we? And we're still learning because we go from... That would be a good name of a church, really. And I believe in this season when I pray about the church and Father tells me, no, they're coming. Get ready. I'm thinking, well, how do we get ready? He said, setting the people. The people need to be ready to represent. Hallelujah. Father, lift up your hands. Say, Papa, thank you. I'm your child. I repent for all my childish ways. Have your ways. Use me to carry someone. To walk alongside of someone. I will never give up. I cannot fail. For you are my daddy. And I give you praise for taking me from glory to glory. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.